Hello everyone, my name is Bradley. I have a Brad Taste in Music, and today we're going to be listening to the 1969 album by the Rolling Stones titled Let It Bleed. Now, I don't really know what it is about the Rolling Stones that really appealed to people, and I say this as someone who hasn't actually listened to really anything from the Rolling Stones, so I'm going into this with no understanding of the artist at all, except for the fact that they are considered to be one of the most essential rock acts of all time. What about them makes them so special? Well, from the shit that I've heard, it seems like they had a lot more edge than many other acts of the time for what they were doing. It seemed like it was, you know, they were like edgy, you know, they were cool. But besides that, I don't really know what I'm getting into. I've heard Paint It Black, you know, I played Guitar Hero. That's about it. So Let It Bleed. I've heard this is their best album. But I'm not sure. I don't even know what it is about these guys I'm looking for. So I guess without further ado, we're just going to jump into this. So with that being said, thank you so much, Squeakle Eagle, for sending this in this week. Today, Let It Bleed. First song, Gimme Shelter. This song is super duper popular. Okay. It's one of those things that looks like a washboard, I think. Tophat. Hold on, wait. I gotta turn on the light. Oh, alright. Should make my face a little less bright, too. Yeah, thank you, man. I appreciate that. Okay. Is this like Dementia the song? Vietnam flashbacks? Okay, first thing I'm going to note is there are a decent amount of elements of psychedelic rock here, especially with the variety and instrumentation. I don't really get a whole lot of... I don't know. There's like a lack of flair that I feel like I've kind of... What am I trying to say? Like the Rolling Stones, from what I've heard, never really popped out to me. And I will say that this isn't like super immediate, but I am enjoying the sound of this. I like that the recording has a little bit of grit to it. Like it is clipping a little bit, but I don't know, something about it, like this kind of shit from the 60s with the quality of recording is always super charming to me. And I gotta say, this is a really high quality song, so I am really enjoying the overall vibe here.
Oh,
I kind of have the lyrics up specifically for people to, like, catch up. I have lyrics for deaf people who join the stream. I imagine that's something that probably meant something else, not to be taken literally. So that was a really strong start. I think the very murky aesthetic of this track is, like, really good at sort of pulling you in, because I don't know what's going to happen after this, but this is just such a powerful intro. The vocals are super passionate. Yeah, it has, like, the soul of rock and roll. I am understanding a little bit better through this. I mean, the performances are amazing. It's just really solid. I like the solo a lot. I like the recording. Yeah, and that's kind of what I could say for it right now. It's just, this is extremely solid. So, smiley ball for me. Really great start. Give that, like, a 9. I have, like, no complaints. I think that that's honestly some of the best shit you could ask for in the 60s. So, I think that sounds amazing. Really, really good. They nailed it. So, let's see where it goes from here. Next song, Love in Vain. Whoops. Oh yeah, I forgot I had a cue on. I started looking at these lyrics and, like, something's wrong. Yeah, I had a cue of songs. I should probably clear that. Whoops. Yo, people are asking for the trap hi-hats. I give you modern day Rolling Stones, you guys. The evolution. This is for my niggas getting high on the regular. Anyways. Love in Vain. I don't want to break up the aesthetic too much. Nice. Well, I followed her to the station with a suitcase in my hand. Yeah, I followed her to the station with a suitcase in my hand. Whoa, it's hard to tell, it's hard to tell when all you love. Can't stand this kind of sound from any song. I'm biased, sorry. I'm curious what kind of stuff you listen to, and I don't say that to insult you. I'm just very curious, like, you know. Looked her in the eye and I said, Lucas Graham. and That's How I Met Your Mother.
Like your profile picture, CHCH.
Station.
I think it Gimme Shelter. It was amazing.
Yeah, when the train left the station, yeah, two lights on behind.
I love this. I think this is literally just, this is wonderful. It's beautiful. Stones are British? I didn't know that. Weird. You know, now that I think about it, I think the Beatles, I haven't given them enough credit. I know it's a random thing to say, but to think about where they started to where they ended up, it's one of those things I feel like I just kind of wrote off. I can imagine, like, how bizarre that must have been in the 60s. British! Yeah, Lucas Graham is Danish. That is true. So, Love in Vain is a beautiful slowdown that I feel like complements the first track really well. Like, you get something in the very beginning that's so murky and so thick, and it's followed up with something that's just very bluesy and calming, but still very psychedelic and extremely well-crafted. It's a smiley ball for me. I like this song. Not as much as the first song, but it's just a matter of preference. I think both are fantastic. Like, I really like this. So, great follow-up. Next song is titled Country Honk. Country Honk. Exactly, Nunez. Yeah, Lucas Graham is a band. It's not crazy to say that there's like a Velvet Underground influence here, right? Even for, like, artists of the late 60s. That can't be too insane to say, right? I feel like I hear a lot of similarities in them. Sounds like a campfire. I love it. Kid Rock inspired.
Fuck all you hoes! Detroit till I die, motherfucker! Talking all that bullshit!
I've not fully reacted to Siamese Dream, no. Honky tonk. Am I mad? Oh, I'm vibing really hard. To the point of where I'm like scrunching. It's American appropriation. Hell yeah, Brandon. A honky-tonk is both a bar that provides country music for entertainment of its patrons and the style of music played in such establishments. Yeah, these guys are just stealing from Kid Rock culture. right here is so jealous right now. This album will take down the stream very quickly, by the way. So when the shit goes down, you gotta be ready to jump on the next one. Was the Kid Rock a rapper originally? He still is a rapper. And a goddamn good one at that. No, I've not heard VU. Oh wait, compilation VU? Or self-titled, or is there a difference? So I like Honky Tonk Woman actually quite a bit. It's another song that I feel like it's a continuation of what's going on in the second track, where things are feeling very laid back. That one is just a really strong vibe, feels very, I'd say even intimate with how it's assembled, feeling also very intentional with everything just sort of being loose. Yeah, just honestly, really solid rock music, Smiley Bowl. I'm enjoying this experience a lot so far. Quite a lot, more than I expected to. I feel like that immediate wow factor that I was sort of expecting from this band hasn't really shown up in the way that I expected it to. I feel like what's making them special right now is very subtle. I think it comes down a lot to expertise and the application of such, as I think that these guys are just really, really strong musicians who are just sort of putting their heads together and making something really strong. So, yeah. Next song, Live With Me. So this song so far, even though I think that it's pretty well executed, it's a style that I just don't really care that much about in the first place. It's one of those songs that, again, has some charm, but just isn't really rolling off the... I don't know, it's kind of going in through one ear and out the other. Maybe it's because it isn't as psychedelic as some of the other ones. It's just sort of more pushing through, run through the motions. It's more story-based. I'm just sort of nodding out. Nodding out? Maybe that's not the right term for that. Sounds like the way cigarettes smell. Yeah, so I get what you're saying, Joshua. The rolling mids. More like the rolling miles.
Yeah.
okay, hold on a second. I thought this was just like, don't you want to live with me like a typical ass love song. What? The meat I eat for dinner must be hung up for a week. My best friend, she shoots water rats and feeds them to his geese. Don't you think there's a place for you in between these sheets? Come on, honey. Build a home. Is this a song about cannibalism? The cook, she's a whore. Yes, the butler has a place for her behind the pantry door. Everything gets so much more intense after that. I don't know, man. That's my interpretation, which, if it is, it's quite interesting. It's a light smiley ball to a strong shrug. Honestly, in my opinion, probably the least engaging in terms of the sound, but the lyrics have a lot to pull out of them, and I feel like if I return to the song and get something more out of it, I wouldn't be surprised. Simp song? yeah, something like that. This one sounds just like a nice song you listen to in the background while you're eating at a burger place. Next song, title track, Let It Bleed. Oh my god, is that Arctic Monkeys feature? Hey, thank you, Ivan. Wait, red headphones. What the hell is this line? Thank you. edgy. Oh yeah, look at that lyric. Being a lord of Canada? Fantastic. Great sleeping music. Oh yeah, the noise gate, you're right.
Fuck all you hoes! Wanna get
So the lyrics here are a little strange, but I think it's what makes the song actually interesting and memorable is just how odd and very vulgar and yeah, it's very vulgar, but it's one of the things that I think actually makes it interesting to listen to. One of the things that actually makes it fascinating to try to dissect what actually is happening. There's a lot of talk of drugs, a lot of talk of sex. And I think what really sold me to this song, though, is the bluesy piano. That is the fucking kicker right there. I feel like that's really what sells this track. I feel like that's really what pulled me in. So yeah, I think that the sound of this track is stellar. And it's one of those songs that I feel like I enjoyed the more it went on. So for me, it's a smiley ball. I actually like it a lot. A strange song for sure, but I like it because of that. I like it because of how odd it is. So, yeah, enjoying it. Next song, Midnight Rambler. Oh, that's nice. Did you hear about the Midnight? I feel like the last song did this better, but I still am enjoying it. Then again, it's only been like 2 minutes. I think that... Is that a harmonica? Whatever it is, I think that sounds amazing. Thank you.
Rockhampton enjoyers calling every rock song mid 10 seconds in will be my punishment in hell. I do think it's interesting that a British band understood how to make blues music really well at the time. That it was considered a American style. Let him cook. Exactly.
Hey, thank you so much, Anthony, for being here. And thank you for leaving such a nice comment. I love this part. It's another song that the longer it goes on, it's like, it's high quality. I feel like it's hard to... Ooh.
It's not one of those. We're talking about the midnight.
Holy shit.
The one who closed the bedroom door. I'm called Hit and Run.
Hey, thank you, Abra.
Anger.
Oh, wow, what?
The knife sharpened, tiptoe.
Hey, these lyrics are very odd, but I haven't really taken anything too literally, and I feel like that's how you're supposed to interpret this art. And I think it's the most enjoyable way to listen to it, as there are some really shocking lyrics here, but it is. It's shocking, but it makes the music more entertaining, so it's one of those things that you kind of take with a grain of salt.
Oh, just shooting dead.
Brad, was that... I was at Woodstock, confirmed. Yeah, Eden, same for me. I've never really understood their image exactly. I've had so much coffee, so if you see me shaking, it's because I'm uncontrollably shaking my leg. You know, Joshua, I was actually thinking of doing a topic video like that, I think. Lyrics that didn't match the tone of the song.
Did you hear about the midnight rambler? Leave his footprints up and down your hall. Did you hear about the midnight gambler? Did you see my name, my midnight call? And if you ever catch a midnight rambler, I'll tell you a message from under your nose.
The lyrics are so down. Exactly. 21. They'd be like a non-stop 21 pilots.
Yeah, I feel like there's something about this that, like, singing, the lyrics, that's what makes this shit stand out. It's good blues rock, but without the absurdity of all of it, I wouldn't really give a shit about this. It's the absurd
crap that actually keeps me engaged. That being said, I wasn't super engaged for the first half of this track. Now, I like the, I don't know if that's a guitar tone or a harmonica or whatever, but whatever it is, that was the spice of the song. That was like the main sound, and it was brilliant, and it was great, and the whole song being built around that was really solid, especially when the whole song slowed down, and then that sound slowed down. It's one of those songs I think is very creative, and overall I enjoyed the experience, though I feel like there were points where I just didn't care too much, despite that. So, yeah, good song, but not my favorite. You Got the Silver.
Hey, babe, what's in your eyes? I saw them flashing like airplane lights. You fill my cup, babe.
Like the second airplane
That's
lights.
Sure.
Line.
Come back.
I got the clue.
You got my heart. You got my soul. You got the silver.
Pumped Up Kicks. Yeah, that's probably my favorite Rolling Stones song. Pumped Up Kicks.
From the mine. Well, that's all right. Buy some time.
Rolling Stone's image was tight pants with big crotch bulges.
Heroin, be the death of me.
Used to think Pumped Up Kicks was a Pink Floyd song? That's really funny. How did you react when you figured out it wasn't?
Is door.
Amazing.
Hey, babe, what's in your eyes?
Dude, the mix on this is brilliant.
The mind, in your smile. I'm okay. No, I don't care.
Yeah, I can't get over that, like, delay effect that would play on one side before the actual riff would play. I thought that was amazing. See, to me, that's the spice of this song. That's what makes it stand out. I like that it's a cool down from the very, like, I'd say overwhelming Gambler track. I think that's really well placed. I think that's really well executed. Just one of those songs that it's short and sweet. Gave me a good experience while it was here. So, yeah, very happy with that. Next song, second to last song, Monkey Man. Will I Am and Mick Jagger have a song together? It's canon. This one's just sonically a really good follow-up.
I am the pizza.
Plastic Monkey Man. Monkey gives it an 8 out of 10. A really solid front to back listen to, at least up to this point. Just, it's like well thought out in terms of like pacing, placement, everything. Are they considered one of the greatest bands in history? You know, I asked that for a long time because I didn't really see what was so special about them. I feel like actually listening to them, I didn't even realize that they were like blues rock. So that helps kind of figure it out. Dude, I've had so much coffee I can't feel my legs.
I'm a monkey! I'm a monkey!
Song where even a simple person can name it. Maybe it's just me. No, it's not just you. I felt that way about it. And I will say, even through this album, I haven't really pulled anything. I don't know, like the identity of it is still a little in the air. Painted Black, that's the only one I can pick. I think Cardboard. Monkey Man is one of those songs that I really appreciate in terms of where it's like lands in the album itself. I think that it's... Yeah, I like the energy of it. It works well rounding out the album as well. I thought that the intro of the track, too, was great leading off from the outro of the last one. Smiley Ball. Final track. You can't always get what you want. I don't know what this is. I mean, I know what this is, but I don't know what this is. You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't know by heart. Because it's like 7.5 minutes. I've heard this track before, but here we go. Oh my god. Oh my god.
Oh my god. Jack, play that back.
Fuck all you hoes! Detroit till I die, motherfucker!
You just think they're a manly psychedelic rock band?
Talking all that bullshit!
Okay, interesting start.
So sick of the hobos, always begging
him.
For change.
You tell them.
I saw her today at the reception. At her feet was a footloose man.
Stop hurting the sun.
Always get what you want. You can't always get what you want.
So I think that this is like,
you can't always get.
It's like at the altar, some girl he likes is like marrying someone else or something.
Sometimes,
I probably ain't gonna be mad at me.
You get what you need.
message. Singing, Xan. I think the singing on this song is amazing. Super bluesy. Holy shit, $315.
Fair share of the
fuck?
Singing words gonna vent our frustration. If we don't, we're gonna blow a 50-amp fuse. Sing it to me.
You can't always get what you want. You can't always get what you want. You can't always get what you want. But if you try sometime.
Song is better than all Radiohead albums.
You get what you need.
Great closer.
I went down to the Chelsea drugstore to get your prescription filled. I was standing in line with Mr. Jimmy. A man, did he look pretty ill? We decided that we would have a sword.
Slippin' Jimmy. Oh my god, guys, it's a Better Call Breaking Bad reference.
Yeah, and he said one word to me, and that was there. I said to him,
you can't always get what you want.
Yeah, Ned's album, he sent in an album.
You can't always get what you want.
Just might find.
You get what you need.
Send in a Cant album.
Oh, yeah.
Woo! Song was built to be a classic. It is kind of true. Songs where it's like everything that happens is predictable, but it's amazing because of it. Because it's so anthemic. It's actually really well designed.
At the reception, in a glass was a bleeding maid.
A lot of people wonder where Ned gets their money from, and it's actually from human trafficking.
Well, I could tell by her blood-stained hands.
And they send it through me to launder it. Whoa, did you hear that? What's going on? Wait, what's happening? Listen, okay, whoa, hold on, you guys, hold on. Guys, okay, this is not a Andrew Tate situation, okay? I'm innocent. Yo, call my lawyer, okay? Call my lawyer. This ain't what it sounds like, all right? Get me out of here.
Hi, I'm sorry, Goodman. Did you know that you have rights? The Constitution says you do.
That's right. I ain't do nothing. I ain't do nothing wrong.
You can't always get what you want.
But if you try sometime, it's just my fine. It's just my fine.
You can get what you want.
Time, you just my back.
got what I deserve. Do I know who Paul is? No. Just get what you want. Would you ever do a video reacting to people's playlists? Nah. Brad, it's Tony from the news, Newsweek, New News. Can you give us a statement of the allegations of you being a top G? You know how it is, you know, I keep all my money under my mattress. Ugh, and this is my address right here, flashing on the screen. Yeah. Good closer, I agree. Really good closer, smiley ball. It's a little repetitive. Maybe it doesn't need to be 7.5 minutes, but I still regardless think that it's really strong, a very positive message here. Very anthemic. I think the choir was a little ridiculous, but overall it landed for me. So, I like this album a lot more than I thought I would, as I expected this to just be a really uninteresting listen. I thought that this was just gonna be dull, outdated bullshit, but I actually ended up finding this to be quite exciting. I thought that the lyrics are very strange, but also extremely engaging. Odd, awkward at points, but never to the point where it's unenjoyable. Always to the point where you're questioning the artistic reasoning behind it, which I think is the mark of a great album and great artists, is to hear something that makes you uncomfortable and then think about it. And sometimes you don't always know the answer, but you're intrigued by it, and sometimes that matters more than anything. For me, this album is a... It's an 8 minus to a solid 8. To anyone who's curious, this is about an 83 out of 100. I think that the sequencing of this album is fantastic. Yeah, the 9 tracks doesn't drag on at all. I think that the sound of this is great. It's overall just a really engaging and fun rock project from the 60s. So, yeah, I'm going to write a quick little review. I have no idea what I'm going to say. Let me think. This is music for top G's. There we go. Thank you so much, Scroogle. I really enjoyed this. Thank you for sharing that with me.